The boxers have been given their instructions. The seconds are out. The crowd is ready for another edition of Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing with your presenter, the boxing historian, Greg Rashid.
I want to say swatty cop to everyone out there. If you're new to the program, that means hello in Thai. And yes, I'm in Bangkok, Thailand. And I'm your presenter today, Greg Rashid, with another edition of the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. And I want to thank so many of you folks out there who have tuned into the program in the last couple of months since we started this endeavor. And those of you who have followed me over the years, over 20 years on radio, and some cable TV. I want to thank you folks and say hi to you, especially hi to all my friends in Colorado, where I actually started out as far as doing radio and cable TV. And I want to thank the folks who listen every Sunday afternoon at 3 p.m. Mountain Time on KUHSDenver.com, created by the one and only, the legendary, Henry Archuleta. And I want to say hi to all my friends in Colorado. I always say I'm coming back there. I am. When you least expect it, I shall return, as I think Douglas MacArthur said. But anyway, we're going to have another fun, great program today. And if you're new to the program, what we do on this program, we do fantasy fights. In other words, we take different modalities. Today we're using, as we usually use, title bout 2PC game created by Jim Trunza. Great game. But there are other games out there too I use from time to time. Legends of Boxing PC, Glory Days Boxing, great card and dice game. There's so many great boxing games out there. And we use that and we just simulate and imagine. Just imagine, because I know if you're listening to the program, you're a boxing fan, you love boxing. And I know you sit back and say, I wonder what would happen if Muhammad Ali fought Joe Lewis or if Mike Tyson fought Joe Frazier. I know you do that. I know you do that. So this is the program where we put different bouts suggested by you. You, the listener out there, you become the promoter, just as Pillow Donald is the promoter of the program today. And you decide what we'll have, what program, what boxing event we'll have, put in the computer, and we see what happens. It's all imagination. It's all fun. Do not take it as something like it's the end-all, be-all, because I can put a match in, two fighters in, and I can do it like 1,000 times and get 1,000 different responses. But we do this for fun, and a lot of people are enjoying it, and I hope you enjoy it. And those of you who have not done so, please go to my Patreon site, Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast, and become a member. It only takes a dollar or so, whatever you can do. Keep the lights on, keep this mic going, keep everything moving and grooving here in Bangkok, Thailand. Also, you can go to the site buymeacoffee.com and just contribute, look for Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast, and donate what you can. Keep us rolling, keep us moving on this program, because we have a great time on here. And besides doing the fantasy fights, we also talk about current boxing. We do that, we do a little boxing history, and also at the end play some music. You know, just an all-around variety show in a sense. And unless you've been under a rock, if you're a boxing fan, if you don't know that there is right now a new undisputed heavyweight champion in boxing, and I'm talking about Alexander Usyk, who beat Tyson Fury the other night being May 18th. If you're listening to this program as we tape this on May the 19th, beat him 12-round split decision. Great fight. Great fight. And that ninth round in particular was a classic. That was something. Some people said that actually, you know, Tyson Fury should have been declared knocked out in that round. But if you haven't seen the fight, check it out. But if you think the ref did the right thing in that fight, let me know. Just send a note to me. You can go to my Facebook site, Gregory Rashid, as a lot of people do. Or you can go to my YouTube site, Nourished by History of War. A lot of you listen to this program. And just leave your comments there, as so many other people have done. But we have a good time on here. But we're going to get to the current news right now in boxing. Starting, and we're going to have a core today. Talk about boxing in the news right now. Starting with the Usyk-Fury fight and the aftermath of it. And some of the things that Tyson Fury said. We're not going to say he's a poor loser, but he's a poor loser. So let's hear what he had to say as we listen to his comments as interpreted by Cora on the Show the Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Tyson Fury claimed his split decision defeat to Alexander Usyk was a result of the judges siding with the new undisputed world heavyweight champion because of the war in his native Ukraine. Usyk was taken to hospital for a scan on an injury that his promoter Alex Krasiuk refused to disclose after inflicting the first loss of Fury's career in an enthralling clash that surpassed expectations. An explosive ninth round in which Fury was given a 10-count after reeling from a series of left hands before then being saved by the bell swung the contest in the new WBC, WBA, IBF and WBO champions' favor. Usyk won 115-112 and 114-113 on two scorecards, while the third judge saw it 114-113 for Fury, who felt he should have been given the decision and even stated it was due to Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
Boy, he made a mistake making those comments. Maybe it's a little, just a brain got a little dislodged or something there by saying that. And I hope he apologizes. But there's supposed to be a rematch coming up in October. But another Ukrainian won the other day, too, and Cora's going to tell you about him.
Whether it was inspiration or perspiration, Ukraine's Denis Baranchuk motored past Mexico's Emmanuel Navarrete by split decision to become the WBO lightweight world titleist on Saturday. Just hours after his fellow countryman Alexander Usyk became undisputed heavyweight world champion, Baranchuk joined the club. "This is a great night for all people of Ukraine," Baranchuk said. The undefeated Ukrainian Baranchuk gutted out a win over Navarrete, who was attempting to join Mexico's four-division world champion club in San Diego. The lanky fighter known as Vaquero fell a little short. Through all 12 rounds, neither fighter was able to dominate and neither was able to score a knockdown. Just when it seemed one fighter gathered enough momentum, the other fighter would rally. A butt caused a slight cut on Navarrete in the 10th round. That seemed to ignite anger from the Mexican fighter, and he powered through the Ukrainian fighter the next two rounds. In the final round, Baranchuk bore down and slugged it out with the Mexican fighter as both relied on their weapons of choice. For most of the night, Navarrete scored with long-range uppercuts and Baranchuk scored with overhand rights. After 12 rounds, two judges scored at 115-113, 116-112 for Baranchuk and 116-112 for Navarrete. Ukraine gained its third world titleist in 1 week. Baranchuk joins Usyk and Vasyl Lomachenko as world titleists. "He's a very tough guy," said Baranchuk of Navarrete.
Very good fight. Another fight. If you haven't checked it out, check it out. It's on YouTube. Check that out. And, you know, it's a shame. It's one thing. I love boxing. Loved it. It's my favorite sport to watch since I was a kid. Since I was like 5 years old when I first saw Floyd Patterson. But, you know, these federations and the IBF now, they're not even going to give Usyk a chance to celebrate being the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world. They're already plotting something, and Cora's going to tell you about this right now on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Alexander Usyk faces only being able to call himself undisputed champion for a matter of weeks. But despite all the attention and build-up to the first undisputed heavyweight bout in over 25 years, his status will only last a fraction of that time. Boxing journalist Dan Raphael has reported that the winner of tonight's bout will maintain the undisputed title for less than 2 weeks. It's said that both Fury and Usyk's contracts dictate that they must vacate the IBF title ahead of overdue mandatory challenger Filip Hrgović's bout with Daniel Dubois. Hrgović and Dubois face off on June 1. A 25-year wait to get 2 weeks of another undisputed heavyweight champ, Raphael wrote on X, referring to Usyk becoming the first undisputed heavyweight boxing champ since Lennox Lewis in 1999-2000. Hrgović has been the mandatory challenger for some 18 months and will be competing for his first world title since turning pro. The 31-year-old is unbeaten in his 17 fights since switching to professional boxing after his Olympic bronze in 2016 as an amateur. Usyk and Fury have already agreed to a blockbuster rematch, eyed for October. Should that be the case, then Hrgović's fight with Dubois would most likely be for an interim world title. Saudi Arabia chief Turki Alalshikh has revealed that the winner of Hrgović vs. Dubois will go on to face Anthony Joshua in September of this year.
Yeah, the good old IBF, all these federations, they try, I don't know. I mean, everyone wants just one champion in every weight class, not five champions on one, just one. Stop the greed, just let there be one champion, one heavyweight champion, one lightweight, one middleweight. I mean, just do it that way, so people can really appreciate it. But, you know, one thing she mentions in that is about Daniel Dubois. Now, Dubois almost beat Usyk. If you remember that fight last year, Dubois hit Usyk. They said it was a low blow, and Usyk had like 5 minutes to get himself together, get his composure together. But when you looked at that fight, that punch was not that, it wasn't actually low. It was on the belt, but it wasn't really below the belt. And I know Dubois has claimed since that fight, because he ended up losing the fight. Usyk did beat him. But he claimed that he should have been the champion after that fight. And I would really like to see, if he can get past his next opponent, I'd like to see Dubois fight Usyk again. I'd really like to see that, because he's got, you know, there's a revenge factor there, but Usyk, he's tough. He's tough. A lot of people are saying, they're trying to rank him already as one of the top 10 heavyweight fighters of all time. I ain't going there yet. I'm not going there, but he's tough. He's a tough guy. You know, one of the best heavyweights I've seen. I mean, he has everything. He has everything, and his determination is just is something. I mean, all fighters are determined, but Usyk is like in a different level. He's just a whole different ball game. So, I just commend him, and I hope that the IBF changes his mind and just let him continue being the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world. And speaking of the word undisputed, there's a new boxing game that's coming out very soon, and Cora's going to tell you about it.
Boxing's big year is about to continue. We can stop asking if Undisputed will officially release and begin the countdown toward a release date on console and PC. According to Steel City Interactive, the independent studio behind the game, they have raised more than $18.8 million in funding. I'm delighted to have such a formidable team of investors in our camp, Ash Habib, CEO and founder, said. They share our vision to bring boxing back to video games and deliver a world-beating, authentic game that does justice to the sport we all love. According to a press release, Novator Ventures led SCI's latest financing round, which included funds from investor London Venture Partners and boxing industry veterans Aegis Climas and Jose de la Cruz, who have joined SCI as advisors. A release date hasn't been confirmed, but based on the pace, it is safe to assume we'll see Undisputed on PlayStation 5, Xbox Series X/S, and PC well before Christmas.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I'm definitely going to get that. I'm getting all choked up just thinking about that. You know, add that to my arsenal of boxing games. But anyway, before we get to the main event, we always like to do a little bit of boxing history. And on this date, May 19th, 1909, Cora's going to tell you about an event that happened then.
On May 19, 1909, in his first title defense, Jack Johnson fights Philadelphia Jack O'Brien to a no decision in 6 rounds in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania to retain his world heavyweight crown.
Interesting. Jack Johnson, I may do a whole show on him, a series of shows. He's one of my favorite, not so much boxers, but just historical figures. And I've been reading, I'm rereading again, and I've mentioned this book, these books on my program before, but there's a book out. It's by Adam Pollock, a series of books called In the Ring With. And he's done everyone from John L. Sullivan, James J. Jeffries, Jack Dempsey, and I have the Jack Dempsey one, but the two-part series on Jack Johnson is incredible. I recommend that highly for anyone, not so much a boxing, to be a boxing fan, but someone who wants to know about the history, about how race in this country, the history of the booming empire as far as technology, because it's all in this book. And books, I should say. Really check it out. It's the reign of Jack Johnson, how he began, how it ended, and all that was going on in history at that time. Fascinating books. Really check them out. And I've been trying. I hope I can get Adam Pollock on the program one time. He does. His books are just amazing. If you're a boxing fan and love, like I do, boxing history, check out his series of books. They are incredible. But we're right now getting ready to get to an incredible guy, the one and only. And he's asking me for, he's negotiating to get a some more money from our corporation. I don't know about that. I'm talking about the one and only Knockout Nigel. He has so many folks that love him now. And we're going to go to the Joe Louis Arena in Detroit, because Knockout Nigel will be commentating on the fight today between two junior welterweights. I'm talking about Hector Camacho, the Macho Man, and Aaron, the Hawk Pryor. Should be a great event. Hope you enjoy. Just sit back. Get your favorite beverage, sit back and let your mind go. Just relax and enjoy this fight between Camacho and Pryor on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. And here's your commentator, the one and only Knockout Nigel.
Cheers. This is your humble commentator, Knockout Nigel, coming to you from the Joe Louis Louis Arena in Detroit, where a crowd of 20,000 are here to witness a 12-round junior welterweight bout between Hector Camacho and Aaron Pryor. The crowd has already shown who they are supporting as they showered Camacho with boos as enter the arena in a chariot wearing pink gladiator trunks with a golden crown on his head. I was told his robe was made from ostrich feathers, which have been dyed purple. Shades of Liberace. His chariot was pulled by 10G-string-wearing beauties who looked like they came from the cast of a Baywatch reboot. My word. Getting back to the serious business of boxing, the bout will be judged on the 10-point system. The judges are Harry Gibbs, Ted Gimser, and Phil Siegel. At Camacho's request, the referee will be the lovely and respected by her peers, Sparkle Lee. Aaron Pryor is pointing at Camacho, screaming Hawk time. Camacho and his corner are yelling back, it is Macho time. Well, be that as it may, it is bubbly time for me as the bell sounds to begin round one. Camacho is circling Pryor. He does a little shuffle and misses with a combination. Pryor lands a right cross for 4 points. That was a solid shot, but Camacho appear unfazed and dances away. Camacho misses with a right cross, then clinches. Pryor pushes Camacho back. Pryor is trying to cut off the ring, but Camacho is moving too fast to trap. Camacho is using his right lead to measure Pryor. Pryor throws a 4-point left hook to the body. Camacho lands a 2-point right hook. Pryor barely misses with a right cross to the chin. The fighters are at ring center. Camacho lands a 2-point right cross. Pryor lands a 3-point right cross of his own. Camacho is on his bicycle again, feinting and flicking out his right to keep Pryor at bay. Pryor steps to the side and lands a 5-point left cross that knocks Camacho in the near ropes. Pryor lands a 5-point right hook to the gut. Camacho appears hurt. Pryor goes upstairs to land a 5-point combination. Camacho cannot get off the ropes. Camacho backs Pryor up with a 2-point right cross and then a partially blocked left hook for 1 point. Pryor misses with a combination as the bell sounds to end round one. Pryor showed he was not fazed by Camacho's darting in and out tactics. I scored that round for the Hawk. Pryor had 27 points to Camacho's 7. Let me take a sip of bubbly as we begin round two. My word, I just spilled bubbly on my trousers. One of Camacho's entourage screamed in my ear, "It's Macho time," causing me to spill my bubbly. Have they no decency to a bloke drinking his bubbly? Anyway, round two has begun. Camacho lands a 3-point combination, then clinches. Referee Lee separates the fighters. Camacho is dancing around the ring. Pryor is stalking him, hoping for an opening. Camacho is flicking out his right. It is not connecting, but it is making Pryor keep his distance. Camacho dances into the neutral corner. Pryor throws a left jab that misses as Camacho dances out of the corner. The fighters are in ring center. Camacho misses with a left uppercut. Pryor continues to stalk his moving opponent. Camacho stops at ring center and lands a 2-point combination and a 2-point right hook. That right hook has caused a major cut over Pryor's left eye. Blood is streaming down his face. As Pryor paws at the eye, Camacho lands a 3-point combo. The cut has opened up more. Pryor is dancing now to avoid being hit in the eye. That eye does not look good. Now Camacho has become the stalker. Camacho pins Pryor into the ropes and lands 2-point right hook on the left eye. Pryor is covering up to protect his eye as the bell ends round two. Camacho was dominant in the second. Pryor spent the majority of the round concerned about his left eye. Camacho is not a heavy puncher like Pryor, but his flicking quick jabs eventually do damage. Camacho pitched a shutout in round two with 12 points. Let me make certain none of Camacho's supporters are near me before I sip this bubbly to begin round three. Don't those blokes realize how rare and expensive this bubbly is? It should be savored, not spilled on one's trousers. Pryor's corner has done a great job on his left eye. Pryor bounces out of his corner with a determined look to end this fight soon. Camacho lands a partially blocked right jab for 1 point. Pryor counters with a 3-point left uppercut. The fighters are in ring center. Hector Camacho lands a 5-point combination followed by a right uppercut. Blood is beginning to seep out of the cut above Pryor's left eye. Pryor clinches. Camacho wrestles out of the clinch and circles Pryor, flicking out his pouring right jab, trying to find an opening. Pryor misses with a combination. He is having difficulty seeing as blood continues to seep into his left eye. Camacho counters with a 2-point right jab on the left eye. Camacho has cut off the ring and pinned Aaron Pryor on the near ropes. Pryor clinches before Camacho can land a punch. Camacho is moving in and out. Pryor is bobbing and weaving. He is being cautious to avoid further eye damage. Camacho is trying to find an opening, continuing to paw with his right. Pryor misses with a cross. Camacho counters with a 2-point right uppercut. At ring center, Pryor lands a 3-point left hook to the gut and then connects with a 3-point combo at the bell. Camacho's corner is screaming, "Pryor hit their man after the bell." That was a very tight round to score. They both had their moments. Camacho had 12 points in round 3-9 for Pryor. I will hold off on the bubbly to begin round 4, as there are some Camacho people hovering near my table. I think they want to startle me again by screaming "Macho time" in my ear. Pryor's cut looks fine for now, but one rapier punch from Camacho will open it up again. Camacho is moving in and out as Pryor waits for an opening. Pryor misses with a left hook, then lands a four-point right cross that got Camacho's attention. Camacho grabs Pryor in a clinch. Out of the clinch, Camacho dances around the ring, occasionally probing distance with his right hand. Camacho lands a two-point right hook and a three-point right jab that opens up Pryor's left eye again. The blood is streaming down again. Camacho is moving about the ring, maintaining distance with his right. Pryor is trying his best to corner Camacho, but he is so slippery. Camacho is bobbing and weaving. Camacho is circling closer to Pryor, trying to find an opening. Pryor lands a three-point left hook. Camacho misses with a counter right. Pryor is trying to find an opening. Camacho is feinting. Pryor moves in closer, bobbing and weaving. Pryor lands a three-point right uppercut at the bell to end round four. Pryor was in control in that round, despite his eye cut. He had 11 points to 5 for Camacho in round four. I will now take a sip of bubbly in peace, as I have been informed that the Camacho supporters have been told to move Camacho's chariot. It was obstructing the view of many on the front row. Camacho comes out in round five and immediately starts circling around Pryor. He will not give him an easy target. Camacho lands a partially blocked right jab for 1 point. Even that little flicking jab has opened up Pryor's left eye again. Camacho misses with a right cross. Pryor is trying to find an opening. Pryor lands a three-point combination. Hector Camacho is trying to find an opening. Pryor is bobbing and weaving. Camacho lands a two-point jab. Pryor is trying to find an opening. Camacho is moving in and out. Pryor misses with a right cross. Camacho is an amazing defensive fighter. Camacho lands a two-point right jab. Camacho is moving in and out. Pryor is feinting. Camacho is cautioned to stop leading with the head. Pryor is trying to find an opening. Camacho misses with a combination. Pryor is feinting. Camacho is moving in and out. Pryor lands an uppercut. Aaron Pryor scores 4 points with a left double jab. Both fighters step in and clash heads. Oh my. Pryor's cut above his left eye looks like an oil gusher. Referee Lee has called time with 18 seconds left in the round. She takes Pryor over to his corner where the ring doctor is looking at the cut. That clash of heads opened the floodgates of blood out of the cut. That is one of the deepest gashes I have seen in quite a while. I don't think Pryor's corner has the ability to heal that wound. It needs to be stitched up. Referee Lee has called a halt to the contest. The judges have gathered their scores. Based on the score tally, this fight has been declared a draw. The crowd has erupted in boos. Cans and paper cups are being thrown in the ring. I know the fans are upset, but the boxer's safety in the ring is the bigger concern. Pryor's cut would only worsen if this fight continues. Pryor is upset and wants to fight, but he will understand later that his safety was more important. The gash is just horrendous. You can actually peer in the cut and see Pryor's eye socket. Horrid, just so horrid. I need to take a big swig of bubbly to calm my stomach. This is Knockout Nigel, returning you to our Bangkok studio. Cheers!
Oh, just horrid. Just horrid. But anyway, there's going to be a rematch, definitely. We can't have those guys just fight to a draw. They're going to be back. But I want to thank again Pillow Donald for suggesting this bout. And there's some other bouts that he suggested, and other people have that we'll have on the program. And if you have a fight that you want, please, please go to wherever you listen to this program. Go to the YouTube site, Nourished by History. Go to Facebook, my Facebook site, Gregory Rashid, wherever you hear this program, and make your suggestions and offer what you want as far as about. Because a lot of people have, and I really thank you for that. Because you can be a promoter like Pillow Donald and so many other people. So happy that, you know, people really love the program. And I love doing it. I really love doing it because it's fun. It's fun, and I get a chance to talk about, on a regular basis, the sport I love, boxing. Would I box myself? Oh, no. But I like watching it. But anyway, as I said beforehand, We talk about boxing on here, talk about combat sports, but we also play a little music. Yeah, because, you know, need to relax, you know, some of these fights, especially talking about all this blood, need a little relaxation. And, I, you know, I started thinking about over the weekend about the later days of Miles Davis. And Miles Davis, by the way, and I'm going to play it on this program sometime. I played it many years ago on another show I had. But he had a great album dedicated to the heavyweight champion, the first black heavyweight champion, Jack Johnson. In fact, it was the soundtrack of the documentary on Jack Johnson. It came out in 1970. But I'm going to play something else by Miles today. It's one of his later songs. And this is a combination of Miles doing some rap. But it's not really, it's more hip-hop. But it's really the sound. When I played this before, people love it. So let's hear Miles Davis doing the doo-bop song on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Specific, he ripped, rage, and brawl, no time for watching Andy Griffith. You can, all you want, go ahead. while he take the doo-hop and mix it with bebop, just like a maker in the shoe shop. Easy Moby will cream you like the nougat. And usually we do our butts and smiles, wanna cool out. You can do that, Miles. Blow your trumpet, show the people this one is the doo-bop.
Just giving that doo-bop sound, just giving that doo-bop sound.
Music sets the pace, but Al Davis walked off the stage.
So what?
Soon as his solo was over.
So what?
Oh yes, he did leave the stage.
So what?
Clean out of sight now.
So what?
Coltrane, he walked off the stage.
So what?
That's what you folks are all saying.
So what?
Oh yes, he did leave the stage.
So what?
And that's a fact now.
So what?
They felt they had to rehearse.
Backstage.
Although we know they are masters.
That's right.
They get a real mellow sound.
So smooth.
And you will have to admit it.
Uh-huh.
But yes, they both left the stage.
So what?
Soon as their solos were over.
So what?
And if you can't figure out
their groove,
I'd like to hip you. Well, my friends, now about Miles Davis, I never know why some people always try to find some fault of this man and his horn. And when they go to wherever he is playing, they seem to go to see whether he is going to tend to business. Spap bop boo ba doo ba doo ba doo 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 dee bap siddly boo bop shoo wop. He never walks around a place and speak to all of the folks he don't know. I wouldn't either. And neither would you, friends. But I know he is friendly. I do.
The rest of us, we do.
Oh, yes. We dig his beautiful soul and we love him and his blue horn. And here's another thing now. About the clothes he wear, I'm sure his style is in the future. He's so cool, the fit of his clothes is perfect. Just like the way he plays, he's not afraid of being different. And he has one most pose in this modern jazz. He and Gillespie are kings. Miles and his group are breaking records, yeah, because they sure do swing. Miles Davis walked off the stage.
So what?
That's what the folks are all saying.
So what?
Oh yes, he did leave the stage.
So what?
Soon as his solo was over.
So what?
Coltrane, he sneaked off the stage.
So what?
That's what you folks are all saying.
So what?
Oh yes, they both left the stage.
So what?
Clean out of sight now.
So what?
They felt they had to rehearse.
Backstage.
Although we know they are masters.
That's right.
They get a real groovy sound.
So smooth.
And you will have to admit it.
Uh-huh.
But yes, they both left the stage.
So what?
Soon as their solos were over.
So what?
And if you couldn't figure out
their groove,
well, I have hipped you. Oh, yes, they both left the stage.
So what?
Chops and roses and whiskers on kittens, bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens, brown paper packages tied up with string. These are a few of my favorite things. Cream-colored ponies and crisp apple strudel, the velvet sleigh bells and schnitzels with noodles. Walkies that fly with the moon on their wing. These are a few of my favorite things. Girls in white dresses and new satin sachets. Snowflakes that stay on my nose and eyelashes. Silver white winter that melts into spring. These are a few of my favorite things. When the dog bites, when the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad. When the dog bites, when the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel.
I don't feel so bad.
great, amazing, one and only queen of bebop, Betty Carter, and that was My Favorite Things. And before that, we did Eddie Jefferson and So What. That's a Miles Davis song. I was going to play the instrumental, but I'll do that next time. And before that, we did Two Cuts by Miles Davis. And if you don't know, the trumpeter Miles Davis, because I got to keep in mind that a lot of folks who are listening to this program, they listen to the boxing, and they might not be familiar with some of the music I play. So I'm trying to hip you to some things here. But anyway, we did Miles Davis, The Man with the Horn, and we started the set off with Doobop Song. And I hope you enjoyed that on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast, because like I say, this is a variety show. The main focus is boxing, but we get into a little bit of everything. You have interviews with authors from various aspects of literature and all that. We have sports figures, and sometimes not necessarily boxers, you know, but it's all about fun. It's all about enjoying yourself, and it's one of my, as Betty Carter said, one of my favorite things, just to make you feel good. But we're getting ready to get out of here, but one more thing I got to say. If you want to promote the program, if you have some boxes you want me to hook up into the computers, on the laptop, on my mainframe or card and dice, just let me know. Just drop me a line, let me know, and I'll be more than happy to do that. You know, because this show is about you. It's all about you. And also, if you got some music you want me to play or some, you know, something like that, we'll be more than happy to do that. In fact, I might play my guitar and banjo live on the program sometime. You never know. But it's all about fun. But again, I just want to thank everyone that tuned in. Thank Pillow Donald again for suggesting the fighters on today's show. And we're going to see you next time. This show, I taped this on May 19th, Sunday, May 19th. So some of the news that you hear, because some of you people listen to it at your convenience, which I really like. So might be old news, some of the boxing news we gave in advance, but it's all about learning, all about fun. Nothing wrong about repeating boxing news, you know, it's all, you know, because that's all good. But anyway, it's Greg Rashid. Go in love and go in peace. Help someone along the way. Do what you can. And remember, when you get up in the morning, get up, go to that mirror, look in that mirror, look yourself in the eye, and hug yourself and say, I love myself. If in sight impaired, get up, hug yourself, and say you love yourself. Because if you don't love yourself, you can't do anything. You can't help anyone. You can't help yourself. You can't do anything. So learn to love yourself. If you love yourself, you make the world a better place. Your community, wherever you are in this world, you'll make it just a better place, bringing positive energy, because it's all about, we're all on the same sphere. We may have our differences, but in the final analysis, we all are here as one. So do what you can to make this a better place. But we'll see you next time on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. I'm your presenter, Greg Rashid, and those of you who want to send a fan mail to the one and only Knockout Nigel, feel free to do that. He'll love to hear from you. But go in love and go in peace. We'll see you next time. Take care.
Thanks for tuning in, my friends. See you next time for another edition of the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. Please don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe to this podcast. Thanks.